This is an update in my continuing coverage of the TRAPPIST-1 system, a star with at least 7 Earth-sized planets, all thought to be terrestrial in nature, some of which could be potentially habitable. Much debate has surrounded the complicated system in determining its characteristics and just how habitable those worlds might be. For more backstory on these planets, see my other updates on this channel. Firstly, some information has surfaced regarding the star and determining whether it is suitably stable for life to develop on any of the planets. One potential pro for life that's been found is that the star appears to be a single star system with no companions larger than a brown dwarf. This is also a positive for accurately determining the sizes of the planets and supports the conclusion that they are roughly Earth-sized. One mark against life is that the star seems to be fairly active. The Kepler-K2 extension mission detected star spots and flaring, with one particularly strong flare towards the end of the observing session. This could be bad news for the atmospheres of the planets, as such flaring could change the chemical composition of the atmospheres regularly, which would disfavor life. Only more study of the flaring will clear that up. Regarding the planets, a paper by Chris Ormel and colleagues, link in the description below, interestingly advances that the orbital resonances seen with these planets are a bit difficult to explain. For the system to form as it did, current models don't predict how. This led the authors of the paper to suggest a new model where the worlds formed further out in an area that would be richer in ice, but also included a method for how the planets ended up rocky. This would favor the presence of significant amounts of water on these planets, some of which may be liquid. But several studies have come out, links to those below, that suggest that radiation from the star could be robbing these worlds of their water. Defining this, however, and determining habitability would have a lot to do with the atmospheres of these worlds, something we don't yet know much about. But the unique nature of the system actually makes them somewhat easier to study than with most stars, since the planets orbit so close to the star. The transits are seen daily, giving plentiful opportunities for future spectroscopy on the system. A bit of information on the atmospheres of two of the planets has already been gathered by Hubble through transmission spectroscopy. From that data, it's been determined that TRAPPIST-1b and C are unlikely to have thick, extensive hydrogen atmospheres, though this is contested and doesn't really say much anyway. Going by our own system, that description covers Earth, Mars, and Venus, which are all radically different planets. The bottom line is that studying the atmospheres of these worlds will become dramatically easier with the debut of the James Webb Space Telescope set for launch in late 2018. This will allow a much more comprehensive study and might even allow for searches of biosignature gases in the atmospheres such as oxygen, ozone, and methane. One particularly interesting development with this system is in a paper by Stephen R. Kane. He reports that the planets of TRAPPIST-1 probably have no large moons, or possibly no moons at all. This paper details that any large moons, such as our own, would have been seen in the transit studies. Smaller moons would have to be extremely dense and orbit very close to their host planet in order to exist at all without being torn apart. This could be bad news for life, since tides are considered a major factor in the formation of life on Earth. However, as I covered in a previous update, tides may still be possible on these planets because they orbit so closely to each other, and because of how close these planets orbit, life is favored significantly in this system by panspermia. In a paper by Manasvi Lingham and Abraham Loeb, they established that given how often TRAPPIST-1e, F and G pass each other, and given that they seem to be the most likely planets to host liquid water and potentially life, they would swap materials very frequently, allowing for panspermia to occur far more easily in the TRAPPIST-1 system than it can happen in our own star system. This would have implications on the transfer for both the organic chemicals needed to start life and also to transporting life itself to the other planets. The researchers state that panspermia between these worlds is on the order of 10,000 times more likely than it would be for Earth and Mars. Given that we found quite a few meteorites of Martian origin on Earth, it's a good bet that it's happening at TRAPPIST-1, opening up the possibility of multiple planets in a system all bearing related life, seeding and backseeding itself to the other worlds. This might lead to some of the worlds having biosignatures that are nearly identical. TRAPPIST-1 is a system that can really go both ways. We may well find biosignatures, or we may find, at least outwardly, a dead system. It's a very complicated place, with so many planets and so many variables, but I also don't think it's particularly difficult for simple life to get a foothold in the universe. The chemistry and odds favor that, along with the tantalizingly tenacious nature of our own simple life here on Earth. Instead, TRAPPIST-1 is really just the first system where we can begin the search for life in the universe in an in-depth way and really start learning about exoplanet atmospheres. Who knows what we will find. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, finally with a new book coming out in a matter of days after a long, glacial slog of getting it out there. It's called Supermind, and be sure to check out my other books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.